first Yiddish word. Yes, the second word is melancholia. That was not a Yiddish word, but somehow we always feel that sense of it. So I say the chayim to you all. That was my bar mitzvah speech 57 years ago. The translation of that is dear cantor, honored cantor, Bobe, my grandmother, higher Elterin, my dear parents, my brother, having the great honor to stand on the bima before you this day, I want to take this opportunity to thank my beloved parents for all of their hard work in trying to raise me as a mensch and a good Jew. What with God's help, I hope to become. That's a true story. Zuni told you a little bit about his background, so let me tell you a little bit about mine. How did I come to give my bar mitzvah speech in Yiddish? How did this happen? Well, my Baba Fagel lived in our house from the time that I was 6 years old until I was eight. She only spoke Yiddish. She was what they used to call Eber Bottle, which means that she was senile. And she would sit on the side of her bed, which was in our living room, and with her was a stocking that was filled with coins from my Meet the Presidents game. Each president had his own coin. And she would sit there day after day after day and count the coins over and over and over again until she nearly wore away their faces and I couldn't tell who was Washington. Was Lincoln. And so every once in a while I would try to steal my coins back. And that's where my Yiddish lessons began. She would come after me as I circled around the dining room table and she would first beckon, Hershula, come here. Come here. Abu Geiste, where are you going? By the way, my Yiddish is Litvakische. This is not what you hear, what you heard earlier. Wait a minute, wait a minute. Zise, Tyre Enekel, come sweet, my dear grandchild. Of course, I kept going around the table faster and faster as she kept trying to chase me, her frustration growing. Come here! Du bist a Masik! You're a devil. Paskunyak! Well, that you know! Good! That's actually a little Russian thrown in with the Mishugana and worse, Ghana. I'm a thief, I'm stealing back my own coins. And so I learned my Yiddish from my senile mother. But the best name that I learned about myself, my father reserved for me. He would say, Zunele, Zise Zunele, my dear son, du bist a chacham balaylo. You are a chacham, a wise person, at night, while you slept. And then you would awaken, and I go, no, what happened to all of that great wisdom? That was my Yiddish lessons. So what is Yiddish? Some people think that it's accented English, especially if you're an American Jew. Moshe Horowitz, he was a greenhorn. He had come to the United States as an adult from Eastern Europe and he struggled to learn English. So of course the Jewish community sent him to a second language school. And there he was asked to spell cultivate. Cultivate? C-U-L T-I-V-A-T-E. Wow, the teacher was so impressed.
Moshe, that's wonderful. Can you use it in a sentence?
He gave a big smile.
Last night after class, I was waiting for the bus to take me home. But it was too cold to wait, so I took the subway instead.
Some say it's... Some say it's, that's correct. Yiddish is the slopping together of Hebrew, of Yiddish, of German, of Hebrew, of German, and the language of origin. For example, Hebrew, mishpacha, that's a Hebrew word meaning family. German, Krankheit, that's your rabbi who's sick. Not Walter. For American Jews, I will tell you a story. We call it Yinglish. In my first pulpit, which was in Baltimore, Maryland, in the early part of the 1990s, in order to ensure the safety and security of Jews that were living under the Soviet Union who had applied for a visa to leave the Soviet Union, they were called refuseniks, and the government refused to let them out. So what the Student Struggle for Soviet Jewry did was to twin us, to link us up with families in the Soviet Union so that the government there would know that we know what's happening to these people, that we're keeping in touch with them. And so my first pulpit, which was in Baltimore, Maryland, Baltimore Hebrew Congregation, we twinned with a family. And because Johns Hopkins, some of the professors at Johns Hopkins, mostly from the medical school, would go over to give lectures in the Soviet Union, we would send them there carrying Chumashim, the five books of Moses, Siddurim, prayer books, and other things that so that these Jews would have the ability to learn about their traditions, which they had been prevented really since 1917 from learning. So we would give them, they would pack their suitcases with these books because they wouldn't dare. They had been invited by the Academy of Medicine of Russia. They would not go through their baggage to check it. They would bring these books. And we would send them to these families. So my friends from Johns Hopkins would go to visit this family that we had adopted. And time after time, as they went to the apartment, they couldn't find them. They had disappeared. Their name was on the door, but no one ever answered the door. And so we became concerned, more and more concerned about this family. And so we tried to discover something about the family. And finally we discovered that in fact a grandmother had been allowed out of the Soviet Union. She had no value to the Russian government. And she ended up in Jerusalem. So our concern led me to call her to see if she knew where her son and her son's wife and children, where they were. She answered the phone, and here I am trying to speak to this woman in Jerusalem, and my first tendency was to try and speak to her in Hebrew. She did not yet speak Hebrew. She was a new immigrant to the land of Israel. I do not know Russian, so I began to speak to her in my Yiddish. That she knew. And I explained to her I've sent a doctor to find your son. Abu is Schwarz, Mishpoche. Dem Abstärzige hat nicht gewissen. Who is them familiar? I'm saying to this woman in Jerusalem, there's dead silence on the other phone. Them what? The what? Them upstairs again. Us? Upstairs again. Do they see them when they're upstairs again? Do you don't know what the upstairs again means? She had no clue. Now, I don't know an American Jew that doesn't know the Yiddish word upstairs again. Then upstairs again. Person lives upstairs. For those of you that need translation.
That's what we call Yinglish.
Part of the reason that we love Yiddish is that it is such a rich and wonderful language, full of body and blood, with very little grammar. I remember when I came home from college as a college freshman, and I said to my father, who spoke 8 languages, but I once asked him, "What's your primary language?" And he said, "What do you mean by what's a primary language?" And I said, "Well, what do you dream in? That's really your primary language." And he thought about it for a moment, and he said, "I dream in Yiddish." I said, "Well, that's your primary language." That was the language that they spoke, although my parents did not speak Yiddish in the house, except the Boga Fagel. But they wanted my brother and I to grow up as Americans, so they struggled with English, and they only spoke English in the house. And when I came home to tell him that there was a course in Yiddish at the university that I was attending, he said, "What do you mean?" And I said, "Oh, here, there's a grammar book." And he went, "A what? A grammar book?" He was surprised. That's exactly what he said. And what I mean by rich is it's rich with superstition, and it's rich with curses, and it's rich with all kinds of human, very human elements. Curses. Kaina hora, so in nit oismaden. Let no evil eye avoid him. A klule is nit kein telegram. That's a good Yiddish word, telegram. Sie kommt nit und er soll dich. A curse is not like a telegram. It doesn't arrive so fast. A favorite of mine happens to be when I was younger, of course, not in my adult life. As men hat das Sach zu tun, liegen men ze schlafen. When you have, when a person has a lot to do, the best thing is go to sleep. But Judaism, Yiddish, was also extremely democratic. It wasn't a language of the Luftmenschen. It was a language of the people, and that was really important. And one of the famous sayings that they had, which I wanted to share with you, is, Nein Rabbonim, kennen ken minyan nit machen. Aber zehn Schusters, joys. Nine rabbis cannot make a minyan, but 10 cobblers, they can make a minyan. And I think that was so much a part of the Yiddish language, the humanity of the language. Yiddish became the language not only of the average Jew. In fact, as Zuni mentioned, by 1939, it was estimated that 11 million Jews spoke Yiddish, more than any Jewish language ever before or ever since. It was the language of the majority of the Jewish people in our history. It was used in politics, among socialist Jews, as well as storytellers. Shalom Aleichem, someone mentioned, Mendel Amacher Sforum, Ivy Singer. In 1980, a group decided that they should collect these Yiddish books, that they shouldn't just disappear from Jewish history. And they believed that when they sat in 1980, that they would be able, if they worked very hard, that they would be able to accumulate 70,000 Yiddish books. That year, 1980, they collected 70,000 Jewish books. They eventually founded what would become known as the Yiddish Book Center, which is housed at Hampshire College, right up here, right up the road in Massachusetts. This center now has collected over 1.5 million Yiddish books. Among others, you can find, in addition to the Yiddish writers, Shakespeare in Yiddish, King Lear. I bought a copy and gave it to a friend of mine who happens to teach Shakespeare at Yale. Guy de Maupassant, Yiddish. Harriet Beecher Stowe, Yiddish, a very popular Yiddish book. Hemingway, Jack London, and Emily Dickinson, among others. A visit there is truly a freilich experience, and I would suggest to as many of you, if you've never been there, to make a special trip to go up to Hampshire College in Massachusetts.